you will, in your hymnals to hymn number 289. This is Blessed Assurance. This morning we're going to look at a passage of the Bible that doesn't get a whole lot of attention, even though it is in the New Testament and specifically in the Gospels, because it's so similar to another passage of the Bible. And the one we will look at this morning is when Jesus fed the 4,000. That's right, he didn't feed the 5,000 this time. He fed the 4,000. And I sort of think this miracle of Jesus is sort of looked at like the redheaded stepchild of the Jesus' miracles in the Bible. It's one you don't really pay a whole lot of attention to for a variety of reasons. And interestingly enough, some scholars have even debated through the years that maybe this wasn't even a separate miracle by Jesus, because it was so similar to the feeding of the 5,000 that they thought maybe Mark got things confused, or whenever people were telling him of these things that happened, that they just got their details wrong. I don't think that's the case. I think that this was a separate miracle, and we'll get into a few reasons why as we get into this. But this should be treated as a unique event, and it's a very important one that we can learn from, which is why we will open our Bibles to that this morning. If you are following in your pew Bibles, you'll find it on page 713, and we'll be reading the first 10 verses of this miracle. It says, "During those days, another large crowd gathered. Since they had nothing to eat, Jesus called his disciples to him and said, 'I have compassion for these people. They have already been with me 3 days and have nothing to eat. If I send them home hungry, they will collapse on the way, because some of them have come a long distance.' His disciples answered, 'But where in this remote place can anyone get enough bread to feed them?' 'How many loaves do you have?' Jesus asked. 7, they replied. He told the crowd to sit down on the ground. When he had taken the 7 loaves and given thanks, he broke them and gave them to his disciples to set before the people, and they did so. They had a few small fish as well. He gave thanks for them also and told the disciples to distribute them. The people ate and were satisfied. Afterward, the disciples picked up 7 basketfuls of broken pieces that were left over. About 4,000 men were present, and having sent them away, he got into the boat with the disciples and went to the region of Dalmanutha." May the Lord's blessing be added to the reading and hearing of his holy word. So we see there are some similarities to the prior miracle when Jesus fed the 5,000 men about 2 chapters earlier. But there are several things that were significantly different too. And that's pretty important, where the first miracle, whenever Jesus fed the 5,000, that took place on what we could call Jesus's home turf. That was in Israel at the time. Now the second miracle, we're not really sure where Dalmanutha is, but if you would go just back a few verses in chapter 7, it says how they were in the area of Sidon. And if you know anything about biblical geography, that was a foreign land for the Israelites. So they're taking place in separate areas, and that is significant, as we will get into in a little bit. Now, if we look back at the first miracle of the 5,000, how many loaves did they use then? Well, they used 5, if you remember, and they fed 5,000 with 5 loaves. In the Jewish faith, numbers were very significant, and I happened to find numbers interesting myself, so I was all about this. So it just so happens that the first 5 books of the Old Testament, the ones written by Moses, they were considered God's law if you talked about the first 5 books. So you have the 5 books is shown or related to the 5 loaves to feed the 5,000. Okay, now is that mere coincidence? Well, I don't think so. Through the miracle, I think Jesus is telling us something very important about God's law and its purpose for the people who partake of it or accept it. How God's law can sustain us spiritually just the same way that a meal can sustain us physically. But there's even more to it than that. If that were just it, that wouldn't be that amazing. But in the first miracle, they tell us that there were 12 basketfuls remaining. Well, number 12 would often refer to God's people, as there were 12 tribes of Israel. So that would make sense that God's law is sufficient for God's people. It's more or less what he's getting to when you boil it down. And it makes even more sense that that miracle took place in Israel, so the message was more so for God's people. In the feeding of the 5,000, Jesus is saying, I am the fulfillment of God's law for his people. Then if we look at the miracle of the 4,000 that took place outside of Israel's borders, it's interesting, you have 7 loaves this time, and they produce 7 basketfuls of leftovers. Well, it just so happens number 7 represents completeness in Jewish numerology. We see in the very beginning of the Bible, God rested on the 7th day because his work was complete. So that makes sense. What wasn't so obvious, though, but with hindsight we can figure out from Jesus' miracle, is that Jesus is saying he is now available for the completeness or the whole number of God's people, not just Israel. He's going outside of his borders now in the new covenant. So he can also bring about the completeness of God's plan through the work that he would do by being crucified and then subsequently resurrected. And it's interesting that just this past week, I had a brief conversation with a friend who was telling me how difficult the Bible is to understand. And if it would have been just written more like a history book, that it would be a lot easier to understand. And I explained to this person that part of the reason that it was written this way is that it gives people the incentive to come to church and to discuss it together and to learn these other things that are going on beneath the surface. So many people say, I don't have to go to church because I can sit in my room at home and I can pray and I can read the Bible. But when you do that on your own, you only get so much. And whenever you are discussing it, like we do at our Wednesday night Bible study, for instance, you can get so much more out of it. So this is one of those things, I think, that you can get that you don't really it's not as evident to the normal person when they are sitting at home and reading their Bible and doing their daily devotions. But through this story, do we see how Jesus made a concerted effort to serve people outside of his convenient realm of influence? And is that what we do? Do we go into the world to find God's people, or do we simply sit back and wait for them to come to us on Sunday? And here's a little hint that 2,000 years of New Testament churches teach us that churches that wait for people to come to them typically don't last very long. And this miracle is reflective of how Jesus did ministry. He didn't even invite people to church or the temple at the time. Not to say we shouldn't invite people to church, we certainly should, but his ministry was to meet people's needs where they are. And then he let the gospel take control of people from that point. And they were satisfied after Jesus ministered to them. We also need to take notice that these people in this area in Sidon, they were not treated as a project by Jesus. And when I say that, I mean Christians oftentimes, you know, they'll come to faith and they are on fire for the gospel and they want to tell everyone about Jesus because they know that he has done a great work in their lives. So I want to go out and I want to get all these converts, I want to invite these people. And they do so, and whenever they get them into church, then they leave them there and then they go to someone else. And they don't, you know, build them up in the faith as they should. They have more or less become a project. I did my job and my goal was to get them in a pew and then I'm done. It's not the way it should be. In Hebrews 12 or 10:25, it says, do not forsake the weekly assembling of the saints. So it is very important to come to church. But it is so much more than that. Church is a stepping stone to greater things. And people can tell if you are interested in them for just bragging rights, that, yep, I got that person in here and that person and the other guy. And that's not really treating a person as a dignified individual. This miracle of Jesus feeding the 4,000 is more support for the notion that if we are truly following the steps of Jesus, then we will do whatever we need to get out there and share Jesus with whomever is we come in contact with. And I think that's what Mark is subtly telling us in this gospel. There is a reason why a very similar miracle takes place just two chapters apart from each other. In the first miracle, Jesus is telling them all of this stuff and teaching them while they are in the company of their own countrymen. Sort of like Jesus saying, are you at least willing to serve your own people? And I would hope most people would say, yes, I'm willing to do that. But it seems like the disciples passed the first test, or maybe not. Maybe Jesus knew they didn't quite get it, so then he had to go back and do something similar again. But in Mark chapter 8, we find out that this is more or less round two of the testing phase. Now Jesus is telling them, when they are in another foreign land, are you now willing to serve other people? Gets a little harder at this point. One way to look at the disciples is that maybe they were more willing to help their own people than they would so people who, again, are foreigners to them. But when the disciples were in their own land, they still can get caught in a trap, though. Do you think there's a chance that maybe they were concerned about what everyone else was thinking? Maybe they were in the presence when they were feeding the 5,000 men, that maybe there are some people here that are going to think bad of us because we are supposed to be taking care of these people, yet we're not feeding them. We're not trying to find a market to buy them food. We're not trying to get everyone to pull their money together so we can go to any kind of market. So people are going to say, what in the world are you people doing? Maybe a little of that was going on too, so they didn't quite get it. And so Jesus had to really push and pull them in order to teach them what they needed to know. And that was about trusting God. You see, there can be very bad influences when people remain in their comfort zone. It was General George Patton who once said, when everyone is thinking the same thing, someone isn't thinking. Those words, I think, are so very true. It's one of my favorite quotes. I heard that a long time ago. And we see around us all sorts of prejudices, and I'm not necessarily talking racial, but we are prejudiced in certain ways. Maybe we have preconceived notions about certain people or certain types of people, and they don't die easily. So that can be a struggle for the Christian as well. Maybe Jesus is giving them an opportunity in a brand new land, foreign people that they do not know, that they haven't prejudged these people, and they aren't necessarily trying to do things that these people are going to expect them to do. So maybe this will be the opportunity for them to actually make some progress in their faith. Sometimes you do need a change of scenery in order to realize your potential. Now, we see with hindsight that the disciples were clearly lost the very first time that this miracle played out. And they're sort of learning as they go. So Jesus is there to hold their hand every step of the way. Surely you would think the second time around, the disciples are going to perform better now because they've already been down this road. Well, they still weren't quite getting it. And the theme that we have been repeating through these last several weeks has been that they weren't seeing it. This is all about sight. It's a theme that's running through the central portion of the Gospel of Mark. And God, thankfully, is ever patient with us. And we see that through this miracle that Jesus was willing to go back to the drawing board, as they say, and show them again because he knew they didn't quite get it the first time. And as I said, some of these scholars say that maybe this was just a confused retelling of the very first miracle. But because people are going to naturally look at this and they'll say, wouldn't a group of people understand the second time around what was happening since you've already been down this road? And as we read it, we see they still didn't get it. So maybe this was just a retelling of the first time. I don't think that's the case. I do think they were that difficult that to get to understand what was going on here. And hey, I think we all from time to time have some kind of a wall you come up against in the Christian faith where it just takes you time to get past and to trust God that much more. I do wonder, or we may wonder, did the disciples even deserve another chance at this, by the way? I don't really like using the word deserve because it suggests there is some kind of an entitlement mentality going on. A lot of times nowadays people say that they deserve this and they deserve that, and none of it is true at all. The Bible tells us that we don't deserve salvation. We don't earn it. We don't, you know, do all those kind of things. But it is because God loves us and Jesus loved his disciples that he gave them another opportunity. Now, we could say that we should be able to rely on God based on his past performance. And what I mean by that is that God gives us a reason to trust him. We don't have to operate simply on blind faith. We can see God did this for me, so I can reasonably expect him to be there for me the next time that I need him. People of other faiths don't always have that assurance. We sang Blessed Assurance, and that's part of the reason we can see that theme going through that song. It's not the case with Christianity. First of all, you know, being saved we know it doesn't have anything to do with how good or how bad you are. And I beat that drum enough in the past that because it is a foundational error that people tend to fall into. I have to keep doing this in order to earn my way into heaven, or when I take my last breath, I'm not sure if I'm going to make it or not. Again, we have the assurance to know that that's not the case, and that we have the confidence to know that God has saved us. That's why we say, I am saved, not I am being saved. But this is so important. What is important to know about God's grace is that he goes above and beyond the call of duty to be gracious, so that the next time we find ourselves in the situation, that we now have the confidence to expect him to be there for us. Reminds me of those financial investment commercials that you'll either hear on the radio or even see on the television from time to time. And they'll tell you about a person who they beat the market average and they earn so much money. And you're supposed to then think in your mind, if I go with them, then I'm going to also make all this money. But at the end of the commercial, or if you're reading it in small print, the voiceover guy says, past performance is not an indicator of future success. Well, I'm thinking, why did you just go through that whole spiel then if it's not going to apply to me? And I know I'm going to be the one unlucky enough that I'm going to lose all my money rather than double my money. So anyway, they're basically saying, yeah, we've done good in the past with certain people, but don't expect us to do the same for you. Well, the thing is, typically, past performance should be an indicator of future success whenever we're talking about God. And God, again, does good things for us, and we see him work in our lives every single day. That way, we will have the confidence to rely on him in the future. That's exactly what he wants. He wants us to be confident that he will meet our needs every single day. One of the hardest things for a Christian believer to do is to trust God. And there's a lot of reason for that, but I think on the top of the list is because God very rarely answers our prayers in the ways that we would like them answered. And whenever it doesn't, we don't get the result we want after praying to God, then we start thinking, oh, that's an unanswered prayer. But we don't have the perspective to realize that, no, it is being answered. just maybe not on the time frame or in the way that we would like it answered. What I have learned is once you accept the will of God for your life, that things will go a lot easier for you. You'll stop struggling with God and you'll stop sulking because you didn't get your way because I prayed for this to happen and either it didn't happen or, you know, it didn't happen the way I wanted. We simply need to admit that there are things that we don't know in the big picture and that we trust that God will work through whatever's happening in our lives for the ultimate good. Sometimes God's will isn't done on earth, which is why when we recite the Lord's Prayer together, we have to pray, "Thy will be done," because it is not always done on earth until he does come back in the end a second time. It's very important to learn to trust God, and I can stand up here and say that, but it is much easier said than done. And it takes a lifetime to prove to God that we trust him. But the large crowd in Mark 8, they learned in a hurry that they could trust Jesus. And the disciples proved to us that you can even have the best understanding of God and his ways, but we just need to be thankful that God cares enough for us that he will walk with us step by step. Jesus himself said in verse 2, "I have compassion for these people." And we are no different. He has compassion for us as well. Maybe you're in a situation this morning where it looks like there's not enough food to keep you sustained. And I'm using that metaphorically. Maybe you're running on empty and you need something to keep you going just a little longer. Remember, God is not going to let you starve. He provides for every single one of your needs. And you can trust him, even though sometimes it seems like you're not getting any results from it. Oftentimes, God allows us to experience these times of need to grow our faith so we can rely on him and trust him even better in the future. Believe me, from experience, those times are not easy at all. They're not enjoyable. But if you're given enough time, you will grow closer to God if you treat it like a learning experience like the people in Mark 8 did, learning from a very loving teacher who has your best interest in mind. It's about keeping our focus on God and not on our problems or the things of this world, because God is so much greater and so much more loving than we even give him credit for. We just simply need to open our eyes and see it. So let us at this time bow our heads and close out with a word of prayer.